What is up, everybody? I'm Tensa, and this is Real Horror, where I take a look at all films, old and new, that the genre has to offer. Today, a new chapter in the Book of Saw is written as a detective investigates a string of gruesome murders that resemble those committed by the supposedly long-gone Jigsaw Killer. I'll be honest, I'm not a huge fan of the Saw franchise. I enjoyed the original, released in 2004, being more of a mystery thriller that had some pretty inventive kills and a cool twist ending. However, it was the kills and traps that became the main attraction of the series, each sequel trying to outdo the previous one with how insane they were, devolving into the torture porn subgenre. From 2004 to 2010, a new movie was released, becoming an annual October tradition, but the storylines grew to be convoluted as hell following the legacy of John Kramer, aka Jigsaw, and his merry band of disciples. In 2017, a reboot titled Jigsaw was made, but poor reception pretty much assured that fan appeal had dwindled. Even after that bomb, interest in the series came from the most random of places, Chris Rock. The comedian expressed that he wanted to branch out into the horror genre and begin with his own story that would take place in the world of Saw. Spiral, from the Book of Saw, starring Rock alongside Samuel L. Motherfucking Jackson and Max Minghinella, was slated for a May 2020 release. But it was pushed back a year after this whole pandemic decided to ruin everything. It's finally out now, and despite not being the biggest Saw fan, I was curious to see if Rock could bring something new to the table. My thoughts walking out of it were just meh. It definitely has the elements of a Saw film, but feels more like it's trying to be Seven with a dash of Training Day. The premise involves a Jigsaw copycat specifically targeting crooked Metro police officers, which opens up a ton of commentary on things that are relevant to today's unfortunate circumstances. Lots of conversations on good cops and bad cops, police brutality, and shady behind-the-scenes actions. Some may think it's trying too hard to convey an on-the-nose message, especially for an entry in a series that's main focus is gory death traps, but it does go along with the series' theme of questioning morals and bringing down ironic punishment to those who have done wrong. My issue is that it all feels very dull. They really establish that the only people you can like are Chris Rock's Detective Banks and his partner William. Everyone else is just an asshole or hardly a presence, so when people start getting picked off, you don't necessarily give a shit because you're set up to hate them. It also plays out as a whodunit. There are references to John Kramer slash Jigsaw, but it's made very clear that he and anyone else from the previous entries aren't involved and it's a copycat killer. Which begs the question, why of all killers would you want to copy Jigsaw? I mean, there's a ton of work that goes into planning and rigging shit up for traps. Why not just pull a Roy Burns and grab a machete and hockey mask to do your dirty work? It's much simpler. Anyways, Detective Banks goes on this whole investigation as people in his department are killed, but it's very rinse, dry, repeat. Someone's killed. Banks gets a box that has the remains of the deceased. He questions suspects, repeat cycle. Oh, but in between there are flashbacks to events during Banks' early days to explain the even bigger story going on. A very common occurrence in Saw. Although, everything does unfold and fall into place in painless fashion, leading to the discovery of the copycat Jigsaw. I won't spoil the identity reveal, but I will say I guessed it with an extreme amount of ease. I had a hunch partway through, then something happens where it becomes blatantly obvious who's behind the mask. Their motivation makes sense, but I will admit that the connection to Jigsaw feels very loose and, dare I say, crowbarred in, when it really could have been its own movie with no ties to the franchise and still made sense. The ending absolutely leaves us with sequel potential, but I'd be fine if we didn't get one because it works as a one-off, and honestly, I'm not sure I totally care what could happen next. As I mentioned, the only real character you're rooting for is Detective Zeke Banks. Chris Rock does a decent job, but I wasn't impressed with his attempt at dramatic acting. Sometimes it was fine, but then there are other moments when it feels awkward and quite frankly cringy.
That was just a diversion to get us out of the precinct! I need everyone on this case!
I preferred him when he's cracking jokes and being a smartass, but even that can be a little too much and feel out of tone. His character also has a ton of shit piled onto him in an attempt to make you sympathize with him. He's a loner that prefers to go rogue with no partner. Most of his department hates him because he turned in a crooked cop 12 years prior. He has a strained relationship with his father, and he's going through a divorce, separating him from his child. This is absolute overkill, and you could have gotten rid of the whole divorce thing because that goes nowhere. I don't want to give the impression that I hated Chris Rock, because he does end up being one of the few things I like about the movie. It's just that he has a ton of personal shit going on, while also fluctuating between comedic and serious attitudes. The only other characters I can comment on are Max Minghinella and Sam Jackson. Minghinella does well as the new partner William, the Ethan Hawke to Rock's Denzel. He's an aspiring rookie with a wife and newborn at home. The friendship he forms with Banks feels fairly genuine, like a buddy cop scenario. Then there's Sam Jackson's Marcus Banks, former chief of police and Zeke's father. This is a big disappointment because they don't give Sam Jackson much to do, even though I think a lot of us assumed he'd be teaming up with Chris Rock. He's in a few flashbacks and you see him twice before he disappears for a large chunk of the film. A missed opportunity for me. Finally, I guess I should talk about the traps, because that's one of the main reasons people go to a Saw movie. They're okay. They're definitely gnarly, but also incredibly ridiculous and overly complicated. I won't spoil them either, because they're definitely an experience, but the explanations and how they work and rules to free oneself from them are over the top. They also do that fucking sped up, quick cut editing that they always done during the traps, and it's annoying as hell. I know it's Saw and they have to be insane, but I would have preferred to return to form with much simpler traps. I'll take the Iron Mask from Part 2 over whatever the fuck that was. Even after a lot of my complaining, I'd say this may breathe fresh air into the Dead franchise, as it is better than any of the Saw sequels past Part 3. It has something to express with its look at the police system and doesn't get its head stuck up its own ass. But the characters are lackluster, the infamous traps are hit or miss, and Chris Rock has to carry the entire thing on his shoulders, dealing with a relatively bland, tone-shifting, and predictable story. I give Spiral from the Book of Saw 2.5 spirals out of 5. But let me know your thoughts if you've seen the movie. What did you think of Chris Rock's attempted horror? Where does this rank among the other Saw entries? And what was your favorite trap? Don't forget to subscribe and follow my Twitter and Instagram. Links to those are in the description. Until next time, everybody, peace.